Okay, so now we will launch the simulation. Before that, we will need to add the code to be written for the HLS, so for in the SDK, says SDK part. Before that, we have to do the export hardware. And after exporting the hardware to the local directory, we will do the launch SDK local to the project. So now we will be writing the code which the processor will be associated with. Okay, so we will associate the ELF file of that code with the MicroBliss processor, and there the configuration part will also happen there. All the commands of the that needs to be given to the DMA, and also the transfer, the initial transfer from MicroBliss processor to the BRAM of that data, the input data that we want to store is going to happen there only. So we have this one. So launch a new application project. So let's say MicroBliss Lab SDK. Okay. So everything remains same, standalone MicroBliss 0, the this one. Okay, everything remains the same, and do the finish one. So this both support package will also be added here. Okay, so let's create a source file. Right click on this one, and here we have a new source file. So let's say this is the main okay, so this is a file that I've created. So I will there is a very simple code that we are going to write here, and okay, so let's just look at the code. So it is almost similar to what we did in the last lab, but there are slight differences because we have the MicroBliss processor here. Okay, so all these are the including files which we need as a dependency. So you are familiar with all of them, right? Although we don't need this one for this lab. Okay, so this is we are doing the 8-point FFT. So everything, mostly the configuration part will be done with respect to this 8 number. So now we'll look at the input. So one thing to take to look at carefully is what is the input that we are giving to the FFT. So we have the input of FFT is 64-bit input. Okay, that 64-bit input is divided into two parts: 32 bits of imaginary data and 32 bits of real data. The input as well as output, both of them are like this only. You have already seen this in the previous various labs for the FFT, that this is how we do the FFT, we use the FFT IP. Okay, so what we have done is we have created pairs of data of real and imaginary. The data is similar to what you had in the last lab. Okay, so it is so if you see the last lab data, it is something like this one. If you see the last lab data, this one. Okay, so this data we have converted into this 11 has been converted into this hex. Okay, you can do the conversion yourself as well and check if it is correct or not. We will also expect the same output as we had in this lab for this lab as well. Okay, in the lab 11, the whatever output was coming, we will be expecting this kind of output as well. Okay, so this is the first pair of data, this is second pair of data. So that is why we have two n numbers of data points to be fed to the FFT IP. Okay, so first of all, this is the initial address of BRAM. I'm going to store the data into the BRAM. So I am XIO, I am using the XIO 32-bit to write at certain addresses. So this address I am accessing, and then I will write this data. So because you have a 32-bit data float, okay? 32-bit data, I am writing 32-bit data and then doing a increment by 4. So which means that because the BRAM is byte addressable, so after 4 bytes, that is 32 bits, I am going to store the next data, okay? So this is how we are going to store. This loop goes on for 2n times, that is because the input data has 16 points, okay? There are pairs of, there are eight pairs of data. Fine. So this is the very similar to last lab. And again, this you have done in the last lab, the configuration information, right? And this again, this is the configuration. So now the main part of this lab is to tell the DMA that you have to take the data from the VRAM and then send it to the FFTIP, and then FFTIP will process the data and generate the FFT output, and that FFT output is to be sent back to the BRAM by the DMA itself. Okay, so this configuration I want to do, and that is why I am using this simple transfer command here. Okay, so you can do the either way, you can go above this and below this as well. Okay, anyways, you will need to wait in the same order. Okay, so if you see this one is the for DMA to device, and this is the device to DMA. So this command basically tells that from this base address of the BRAM, pick the data. How much data? This much amount of data. So size of float, because we have the float data that we have sent, 32 bit. And how much data? 2 into n. 2 into n number of points of data I have. So this much data has to be sent to the device. So this is a for the FFT. Okay. And from FFT, what you need to do is you have to take the data from device to DMA and store it where? Store it at the offset of this much from base address of BRAM. Okay. This base address of BRAM and this much offset. And again, we are doing this because we do not want the input data to be overwritten. Okay, because we have written the data from the base address and this much data has been written. So I want to write the output data into BRAM after this much. Okay, after this much increment. Fine. And how much data again? The size of data remains the same because the output of FFT is also going to be this kind of data only. Fine. So again, we are going to check the status again. This halted mask is there, and this is the off offset of the particular register. This is similar to what you did in the previous lab. Okay, so this one is the similar to what you did in the previous lab. Fine. So we will be checking the status again and again, and finally, as the status becomes one for both, so transactions have been completed, and we'll see the output simulation. Okay. Fine. So this much is fine. I'll be saving this, and then we'll see that the build has finished. Now we can simply go here, and we have to associate the ELF file. Okay. Associate the ELF file. Go here. Add files. So go back to the particular folder. Lab MB would be the one. So let's look for the R. Okay, so this is the project folder. Go inside this one. Go to the SDK. Again SDK. Then debug. And this is the ELF file that you need to attach. Okay. So this ELF file has been attached here. Okay. So now you have to launch the simulation and check if it runs fine. We'll continue after the simulation is launched. Okay, so now we will observe the simulation waveforms here. Okay, so let's just first go to the DMA1. So this, you have to go to the DMA and you'll find various signals here. Okay, so we will add these signals. Okay. So first, we had some dividers for better observability, DMA to IP. The DMA to IP is the memory map to slave axis, okay? Because we need to now add this to a wave window, okay? So this is a DMA to IP one. Then we will do the IP to DMA. Okay. So this one will be the slave axis S2MM. And then again a new layer. Now VRAM to DMA. From the VRAM to DMA, you have the M axis. MXI, this is the XI port. New divider. VRAM. So from the DMA to VRAM, the output will be sent like this one. And let's finally observe this MAXI S2MM. Okay. And this light port is the DMA configuration part. This one, let's add this one. But to see the VRAM signals as well, I will go to the XI VRAM. In the XI VRAM, you have these various signals. So go to this one, and then you can observe this one as well. So let me add these here. Non-A-Psi VRAM interface. Okay. Just simply add these signals here. This would be fine. Okay, so let's add these for now to the wave window. Okay, now we will start the simulation and let's see. So here you see that there is some output that has arrived. Okay. So first, let's see that if there is something on the DMA configuration part. Okay. So there is some thing that you would be able to observe here. So the DMA configuration part is taking place here. Okay. This is write operations read, and in the channels you can observe the data as well. So the data for the configuration part is being received in this part of the process. Okay, and then as you see that here from the now what should happen is the from the VRAM the data should move to the DMA. So let us observe these signals first. Okay. So let's observe this one from here. If you look at the data that is going from BRAM to DMA, here you'll be able to see that whatever the data have you written here is being sent. So this is the real part, this is imaginary. So this is why we want it to be the upper part. So the similar data and check is going from the processor to the BRAM. Okay. So this is the one, and you can also look at the address one. Okay. Now, yes, so after this one, from BRAM to DMA, now from DMA to the IP, that is your FFT IP, the data, same data should go. Okay, so let's check. So once again, you'll see that the same data that is here, 41B80000. And then 413. So this is going in a clubbed form. Okay, this data is going in a clubbed form. This becomes the lower 32 bits and this becomes the upper 32 bits. This is how the data is traveling. You'll see that after 8, the last signal is also coming. And as this goes on, the T valid is also being received. That this data is valid. Okay, once this goes inside, so what you will expect is the data should come from IP to DMA. So after some time, some latency that the FFT is taking, here you have the data output. Okay. So this is the output. So this is hex output. Okay. So this should be similar to what we had in the previous lab. But for now, let's just skip this for a while and just complete the sequence. Now from DMA to the BRAM, again, some writes will happen, okay? This is the write data. So this data, that is the output, should go here as well, okay? This kind of data will come here. Again, this is the hex data. We will be verifying that this is fine or not. So this is being stored in the BRAM again, okay? So now, finally, let's just look at the addresses as well. Okay, the address that you are giving is this one. Okay, it should be ahead of the base address. Okay, so let's look at the base address. So this is the base address of. So this is the base address of your BRAM, and from here you had written the previous data, right? The input data, but input data does not start from here. This is the address from where the input data starts. So this is why we have given an offset here. Okay, this is the offset that you have given. After this offset, the write operation starts. Okay, why did we do so? Because we did not want the data to be overwritten. So this is done, and then you'll see the T last is also coming. So once we are done with all the signals, so we can have a look at the output and try to validate if it is correct or not. Okay, so in this one, let's look at the outputs. What I will do is I will convert this hex data in the output hex data into a float, and we will check that if it matches with the previous lab or not. Okay, I will copy the value, put it inside the converter. So let's check the lower bit first. Convert to float. We'll get a 385 here. We'll see the real part is 385. So because this was the lower part. Now let me check the upper part. convert to float. 379. So this is the 379. Okay, so in the previous lab as well, you are getting the same output. So let's check one more output for ensuring that this is correct. This one. Okay, so let me just copy the value and again do the similar procedure. Copy this here, convert to float, minus 103.808. So let's look for this one. So this one is here, the real part, because it is the lower part. Now let me look at the upper part as well. And this should be the minus 119. That is the similar one. Okay, so the output is also validated. So the design is working. So for this one, what you have done is used the microblaze processor and done the FFT. Also, you have transferred the data from BRAM to FFT and FFT to BRAM by using the DMA IP. So thank you.